and then make a motion to go into the closed session, so. Okay, welcome Oregon County Commission meeting, March 15th, 2022. We will start the meeting with a closed session and then move into a work session. Following the work session, we will commence our regular meeting. Do we have a motion to move into the closed session? And please include in the motion the purpose for moving into the closed session, which should be to discuss the character and competency of an individual and litigation, reasonably imminent litigation.
We don't have to have Garrett here or anything.
So moved.
Commissioner Wilson.
We have a motion, do we have a second?
Second.
Okay, a motion and a second. This will be a roll call vote, so we'll start with Commissioner Fackrell.
Aye.
Commissioner McConnell.
Aye.
I vote aye. Commissioner Anderson.
Aye.
And Commissioner Wilson.
Aye.
Okay, motion passes, we will move.
He's like, oh great, this is starting all over. That's why I had a problem seeing last night too.
So I have the request to pay our lawyers for $40,000.
Oh yeah, I need to.
So I don't know why I asked the department head, but you want me to sign it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, it's gonna go on the same check edit that we all signed, so.
Yeah.
Oh, actually it already has, because it's on the sauce time over, so.
I know he was the chair of our department head, but I'm stuck, at least that's what I was doing, and he was the chair. Department head is it?
You are now.
Hey, Jeremy? Jeremy, hang on a second. Come here, Jeremy. Jeremy.
Jeremy, see who's saying my name.
Did you see my changes to the minutes? I copied you on them and on the letter.
Apologize.
Okay. Oh, it's not a big deal.
So next week we'll have the same problem. That's why I'm saying no.
Okay, we're going to go ahead and get started with our regular meeting. We will first have a motion to move out of our closed session.
I move that we move out of closed session.
Will you state the purpose for that?
For the purpose of competence of an employee and litigation.
Okay, so we had three items that we discussed in the closed session: character and competency of an individual, potential and reasonable litigation,
and
the potential acquisition of property.
That's correct. Sorry.
We have a second on that motion.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. This will be a roll call vote. Second was Commissioner Wilson.
Don't waste any time with me, buddy.
Commissioner Anderson, how do you vote? Commissioner Fackrell, how do you vote?
Aye.
Commissioner McConnell.
Aye.
I vote aye. Commissioner Anderson.
Aye.
And Commissioner Wilson.
Aye.
Okay, motion passes. We are now out of the closed session. We will move to our regular meeting, March 15th, 2022, Morgan County Commission meeting. Welcome to the members of the public that are here. We will start with an invocation and moment of reflection. I've asked Commissioner Wilson to take care of that.
Our Father in heaven, we bow our heads at this time with gratitude for our blessings, grateful Heavenly Father to live in this beautiful community, thankful for the residents here, grateful for everyone that takes of their own time to serve one another. We're thankful for this evening that we can take care of our county business. Pray that we can do so in a manner pleasing unto thee and that we can help our county residents here. We pray, Heavenly Father, especially right now for those people of Ukraine and Russia that are suffering. We ask you to watch over and bless them and pray that some cooler minds can prevail and they can get out of this war. We're thankful, Heavenly Father, for all our blessings. We're grateful for the freedoms that we enjoy here in this land of America, and we pray that we might always have that. We say these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. Thank you, Commissioner Wilson. We will move into the consent items. First item is approval of the March 1st, 2022 meeting minutes with corrections. Commissioner McConnell provided a number of corrections. Julie, did you get those earlier today? Okay. Are there any other corrections to the agenda?
There were some more.
To the minutes?
There were more, but I can go over with you later. It's just English.
Okay. It might be where you are.
No, I've already looked at all of his.
Oh, okay.
So
okay.
I looked at all of yours, and there were a few more.
Okay.
Sounds good.
Okay.
So I'll move that we approve the March 1st, 2022 meeting minutes with the corrections.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve the March 1st, 2022 meeting minutes with corrections. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Motion passes. Next consent item is approval of resolution. Mr. Austin Turner. Consent needed on the resolution. Is Austin here? I believe he is.
So this matter was before us previously. This is just the form of resolution.
Yep.
I do have the number also.
Okay. So we did previously discuss this matter. This is on the
bridge
emergency management budget. This is the money coming out for the
flood
in the Peterson area.
It's 2022 dash what? Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we approve resolution number CR-22-03, a resolution authorizing a correction to be made to the emergency management budget.
I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve resolution CR-22-03, a resolution authorizing a correction to be made to the emergency management budget. Just for public information, this is transferring $3,525 from the flood disaster fund into the emergency management budget line item to pay for work that was done during a flood in the Peterson area. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Next item, Mr. Garrett Smith, approval to sign the additional joinder for the prosecutor contract, correct? This is the e-prosecutor contract.
Yeah, so this came last commissioner, let's see, it's been about a month ago, February 15th commission meeting. We submitted it. I included an email from Ronald Waite, who was going to onboard us onto the system, and he mentioned that there was another joinder that had just been sent to him 2 weeks prior that he had forgotten to send to us. And so this is just specifically for the maintenance fees that were a separate portion. So there's the fee for the user, and then there's also a separate maintenance fee, and this is the joinder for those maintenance fees. It's already been approved in the budget. This is just an additional joinder that I was looking for permission to sign on behalf of the county.
Okay, any questions on the item? Okay, we'll look for a motion.
Mr. Chair, I'll move that we authorize Garrett Smith to execute the additional joinder for the e-prosecutor agreement related to the maintenance fees.
Okay, we have a motion. We have a second.
Second.
A motion and a second to authorize Garrett Smith to sign the additional joinder for the e-prosecutor contract. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed? Motion passes. Okay, next and last consent item, approval of letter for the Mountain Green residents regarding fire lane and no parking zone on Robinson Lane in Mountain Green.
Since sending you guys the copy that I sent you, Commissioner McConnell made some wonderful adjustments, and it's even better now, so if you'll approve it, I can send it out.
Did you run that, those changes by Chief Brendel?
I don't think I did, and so I will do that tomorrow.
Okay.
So if you want
to... We can approve it still.
Approve, given his review.
He already approved it before Commissioner McClung's changes to it.
The only, I think, substantive change that I would want him to verify is I put the boundaries of the two lots, and I just make sure that's what he's planning on.
Okay, do we have a motion?
Mr. Chair, I make a motion that we approve the letter dated March 9th, 2022, to residents on Robinson Lane, with the amendments made by Commissioner McConnell and upon approval from Chief Brendel.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion, a second to approve the letter, and we'll also seek an approval from Chief Brendel as this is in the Mountain Green Fire District. Commissioner McConnell. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Okay. We will move into item C, Commissioner's Declaration of Conflicts of Interest. Any commissioner conflicts with any item on the agenda?
I have a conflict with respect to item F2, the proposed amendment to the Springview Phase 7A plat, as well as the part two of that, which is the approval of the Springview Phase 7B. I represent the developer.
Okay. Thank you. That conflict has been noted. We will now move into our public comment period.
Can I just one thing. It seems like annually we sign an annual conflict disclosure for all of us annually, and it's a list of the different conflicts. I don't remember doing that this year. Will you check with Leslie on that? Stacy usually brought them in. She usually had our ones from the last year that were kind of... And then we just provide any updates. But I think we might want to do our annual
disclosure. I don't think I've ever
disclosure.
Done one.
I was going to say I haven't done one.
Yeah, but we should definitely do that then. Thank you for noting that. Okay, moving into our public comment period. This is an opportunity for the public to address the commission. We do not have any public hearings on the agenda tonight, so this would be your only opportunity to address the commission if you're not an applicant. Or have a specific agenda item. We will ask that you state your name and please limit your comments to about 3 minutes.
You can take two and pass it along. Hi, Michelle Ryman, Mountain Green. I came not last meeting, I was out of town actually for the last meeting, but meeting prior to that, and had made two requests for the council. One was, this was regarding the landscape buffer between the airport and the residence home. The first one was to request the increased hangar size not be increased from what the plan was. That's the one that was a 60 by 80 and a 60 by 70. Those increases I asked to have them not approved. The second one that I requested was to have the water to that buffer put in with the infrastructure that was going forward in the airport. A few reasons for that was, I think, cost effect wise for the county is a big thing. Trying to get water over there after the infrastructure is done, it will be quite a headache. After doing that, I was asked a question by one of my fellow airport board advisory members and said, is this just your opinion, or do you have, are there quite a few members in the county or in the area that share that? So I went out and talked to quite a few of the community members, which is what you're looking at. I talked to them about my concerns and just about what was going forward. Many of them were not aware of any of it. They were all super excited that you guys have said that you'll look at doing, finishing and completing the buffer. but they had some of the same concerns that I did. So what I did, because many of them were not able to come to the meetings with work in that, I just typed up what we had discussed, and I went around and asked them if they agreed with it, if they would sign it. The majority of the people that I had time to go to, of course, are the neighborhood that is just directly across from the airport, right along Little Creek there. So since then, just within a few of our meetings, there has been a little bit of a discrepancy of the amount of water that was available for the airport infrastructure. I know when it was first brought forward to me, our chair over the airport advisory board had thought that there were 5 hookups available left. Since then, I had gone to an airport or a water board meeting and was told there were only 3. And so investigating that a little bit, there was some miscommunication between the water company and George Sousa, where he thought there were 5 hookups available, and there's actually only 3. With that being said, the information that was brought forward to you guys at the time when George brought it forward and it was passed, we were under the assumption that there were 5 hookups available. I've talked to George and the board since that, and he had mentioned that he had contacted Bobby to let you know that. But my question on that now, of course, when there's only 3 versus the 5, that does not give us enough water, not only to get water to the berm, but that also makes it so part of the infrastructure that has been brought forward to you, there's not enough water for. Just information that I'm bringing forward to you on that. Also, in talking to our community members, they had a few concerns they wanted me to voice to the commission. There were 2 different neighbors that said that they had been trying to find, they wanted to go to some of the airport board meetings and didn't know if that was a possibility, if it's an open meeting where they're allowed to go to or if it's not. They also were concerned, they had tried to look up meeting minutes from those meetings and not been able to find those. I don't know if that's something that we're just having an issue with the website or why that is, but they weren't able to find it. They did contact the airport manager and didn't receive much more information of where they could find that at. The biggest concern that they voiced was the impact that the development is going to have on the community. When they did the master plan for the airport a long time ago, when it wasn't even as big as what we have now, there, to my knowledge, was not an environmental impact study done, which should have been done.
Based on what?
Based on, Joe said he had it, and I've asked him to give it to me, and I haven't received it yet, so that was my next sentence. Bringing that up to the airport advisory board, I had asked if there was one done. Joe said there was, and he would give it to me. I'm hoping to get that. We just haven't touched base on that. My question on that was that study done on the old plans that are filed here that you can look up? And I think those were done like in 98 when the master plan was done. Or was that impact study done on what has just been brought forward to the commission? So that's just a question I have for you guys. I'm trying to research that and find that information out. But if one of you did have that information or did have a copy of the impact study, I would love to get a copy of it. And a lot of concerns on flight patterns. I know there are some rules and regulations on that, but I'm not sure how that's being policed. There's quite a few concerns on that within the community, and that kind of sums it up. But I just,
what kind of flight patterns are they concerned about?
I believe the flight patterns, what I've been told, is they're supposed to go out pretty far past where the Cottonwoods neighborhood is, kind of back where the they used to run the sheep. I don't know if you're familiar with that area, but behind the homes, and they're supposed to go around. What happens a lot of times, and I heard from multiple neighbors, is they just circle the neighborhood. We have one gentleman who is an ER doctor and works nights, and so he's trying to sleep, and he's like, I can't even get in a room dark enough, or sound barrier to cover that noise, and it's kind of affecting his work. So, yeah.
This is just a point of order, just for public comment. It's not really an interaction between the commission. If she would like to get on the agenda, there's more interaction. This is just a comment that can be made to the commission, and then follow-up discussion can happen outside the meeting, but just for order's sake.
Okay, and for just referencing that, I hope to get on the agenda for next meeting. I had a hard time. Was out of town and was not able to get on the agenda for this meeting just because I didn't get signed up on time, but I will be on that for next meeting so then we can have an open discussion on it.
Great, thank you.
Hi, my name is Gary Stettler. And I'd like to just kind of follow up with Michelle, and I thank Michelle for what she's trying to do for the community, because basically, in a nutshell, what we've noticed as citizens, I've lived at Willow Creek Road for 20 years, and during that 20-year period of time, I have never, ever been approached by a member of the council. I've never been approached by anybody formally from the airport board. Only once were we ever involved with anything, any kind of development with the airport, and that was when, way back, when Mike Babcock tried to get a development going, and it was denied by the council. But at that time, we were at least promised that they were going to do some landscaping and put a nice fence in, which, of course, still in 20 years later hasn't taken place. Apparently, looks like it may not take place ever. I just bring to the council that, you know, all of these different things, whether it's that we can get a representative, another representative on the airport board, or go to their hearings, or do something, after 20 years, it just appears like the only thing that anybody's interested in is what the airport wants, not really what the citizens around the airport want. And that's disconcerting. That's all that we really want, was some representation. I have nothing wrong with the airport, but it seems like we're... And Michelle's not the only one, other one. We had another, my next door neighbor was actually on the airport board, and I would get the same kind of response from him, that anytime he would try to bring up anything that the neighbors were interested in, or concerned, or wouldn't they consider something, they were always turned down, or disregarded, or minimalized. And that's all I'm asking from you folks, that we take a look at that. You know, I don't know if somebody's trying to run roughshod, or what the situation is, but we're not being fairly represented, is what I can tell you. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Okay. Seeing no additional public comment, we will move into item E, Brett Heiner presentation.
Thank you, Commissioners. I'm here on a little lighter note today. I'd like to talk about how this county's been helped out by other counties in the state on some of our disasters that we've had in the last year and a half, if you remember. Does everybody remember the windstorm we had September 7th, 2020? Mm-hmm. Well, I'm here to talk about your fire chief and your emergency preparedness. I'm telling you that your system works, Commissioners. Your system works well, and it served us well in my position, how we have been taken care of and these citizens of the county have been taken care of. I'll get back to the windstorm here in a minute. We'll move on to the fire. Do you remember the road shop burning down December 14th, 2020? What a year we had. You know, that burned up six of our plow trucks, our loader, two of our ton trucks. I had one plow truck left at the end of that fire that night. I'm here to tell you that our emergency management crew, you don't find any better. The system worked again. But what really worked is, Austin isn't here, I don't think, tonight. I'd like to honor him a little bit. But by noon the next day, with his phone calls, we had our plow trucks replaced by neighboring counties and UDOT. The state were phenomenal on how they stepped it up. I had more trucks loaned to me by noon the next day than I lost. To give you an example, Utah County, how far away is Utah County from here? It's not right next to our county. Their public works director called me up and said, I'm sending a truck up. I've got one guy following him so he can take my guy back home. He said he'll bring it up, be there in a couple hours. They brought the truck up, parked it out on our road right next to our road shop with no strings attached, and said it's ready to go full of fuel. Keep it as long as you need it. I mean, what a great place we live. And the reason I come today is UDOT. I've got one representative there, and come on up here with me for a second. UDOT, area supervisor, got a hold of me the next morning and says, Brett, how many trucks do you need? We have all the trucks you need. We'll have them ready to go. Darren, he's one of your UDOT drivers that keeps you guys going down the canyon in the middle of the night, spends all night to get the freeway going. Anyway, you know, we just can't say enough about how this county has been taken care of in a disaster, and UDOT has been so good to us. To go back to the windstorm, when that windstorm happened, our salt shed got damaged beyond repair. That was quite a task to get that repaired. We couldn't really start the project until we got a few things straight last summer. Well, that put us without a salt shed. So Darren and his crew come over and said, what are you going to do with your salt, Brett? And I said, well, we're going to have to stack it outside. I don't want to, but we're going to have to stack it out and maybe ruin it. We don't know. And they said, why don't you bring it over to our shed, put it in there, keep track of what you put in there, and then use what you need as you come out. These guys stepped it up again just last fall. Well, we thought maybe we'd have the salt shed done maybe in November. It took till December 27th. I run out of that salt, and so again they said, well, just have your salt delivered over there, just keep track of it. And what would we do without them? I think you know, they owe a great, you know, gratitude from the county. And what a great place to live in Morgan County. Don't you agree, commissioners? This is small town America. This should be on the 6 o'clock news. This is a great place to live. And Darren, I appreciate you. Thanks. And all you do for us. Can we give him a round of applause?
Darren, thank you. And thank you to UDOT, to our surrounding counties that helped us out, our own folks. Brett, you aren't taking credit for yourself, but you did a lot during all of those things, all of those disasters, and have continued to. We didn't get our road shed rebuilt until, well, last, no, I guess January
we finished it.
So it took just over a year. But we couldn't have dealt with all of those issues without the help of UDOT, so thank you. Please report that back to all the folks you work with. We really appreciate them, and I agree wholeheartedly, Brett. That's what small town America is all about, right? Helping each other. So thank you.
Thank you, commissioners, for letting me do my job. I appreciate your support.
Could we give them their trucks back?
We did give them their trucks back.
Appreciate
some of them
that.
Got back a little better than they came to us too.
Yeah. Right. So
thank you again. All right, we will move to our second presentation of the evening. This is a presentation of the TTAB board. Commissioner Fackrell.
Yeah. Basically, a lot of people are wondering what we're doing in tourism and using of the money of the county. Actually, it's not the county. It's the money of the TTAB, or the TRT, which is tourism, restaurant, and
Transient
room tax, thank you. There's three of them. And those funds are restricted funds and cannot be used for certain things. So I thought it would be good for the TTAB board to come in and kind of explain who they are, what they're doing, so that everybody has an idea, and just take a few minutes.
Wonderful. While they're coming up, just for the public's benefit, TTAB just stands for Tourism Tax Advisory Board.
That's correct.
We use a lot of acronyms in government. I guess in every industry you do. But
in fact, we have another one that's called ATAB. So, you know, you've got TTAB and ATAB, Active Transportation versus Tourism and Tax.
Okay. Good evening, commissioners. Thanks for having us on the agenda. So the Tourism Tax Advisory Board, we wanted to all come, although everybody couldn't be here, so a few of us made it, just to introduce ourselves and give an update of what we're doing.
So I'm Donna Zucchirmi. I am an owner-operator of Destination Sports, a local outfitter here, river rafting company. I'm also on the board of the Weber River Partnership, newly formed nonprofit organization, and I sit on the board of the Tourism Tax Advisory Board. We also have Rachel Turk. I'm Morgan County historian. I'm the director of the Morgan County Historical Society, and just recently have been added to the TTAP board, and I'm really excited about being a part of that as the collaboration of projects that I'm working on with designating historic districts, improving some of the facilities that the city owns that we could potentially use to as part of the tourism element of our economic development.
My name is Mauricio. Some of you may know me already, but I also do run a couple businesses in town, including the local fishing store, a travel company, local newspaper, a couple other things that we're involved in, plus sit on the WFRC board, TTAP board, the chamber, the Wasatch Front Regional Council, the TTAP board, and there's probably some other ones that I'm forgetting.
Chamber.
But
chamber board.
Yeah, the chamber board, stuff like that. But yeah, the cool thing about what we, with everything that I'm involved in, the real positive thing that we get to experience with the TTAP board is that it's one of the boards, even though there are many, that is moving a lot of stuff forward at a rapid pace. In order to help benefit not just the local citizens, but the local economy and the community itself and the business community.
Chris wants to go last, so I'll just introduce the folks that are not here. So Jeannie Patterson, who's the general manager at Cobblestone Hotel and Suites, Bryce Spear, the general manager at East Canyon Resort, Davey Ratchford, the general manager at Snow Basin, or one of his other management team representatives, Eric Manning, the CEO of the Northern Utah Trails Foundation, Kelsey Tuttle, the owner of the new owner of Taggart's Grill Restaurant, and then we also have Blaine Fackrell as the county liaison, Ty Bailey, the city liaison. We are missing, we have an empty spot. We would like to recruit somebody from the Morgan County Fairgrounds Board, who maybe isn't quite as busy as some of our other board members. And thanks very much to Anissa. She's not a board member, but she is the director of the tourism development. The director of tourism development. And we've really been working under her direction. And also, she's working under our direction and under the advisement of the county. And so she's helped us a lot to kind of help us focus some efforts.
I need my paper so I can tell you who I am. No. Chris Haramoto, I'm the park manager of East Canyon State Park. And our newest state park in the state park system is Lost Creek State Park, which is coming along very nicely. It was an honor to be on this board as well. The Tourism and Tax Advisory Board, just because it plays an integral part, obviously, within the tourism, especially when we talk about our state park system. And as you can see from the names that Donna read off, we have an all-star lineup, right? And it's so easy, as you can see with the people and the professionals we have here, right, to make things move forward, right? It's just amazing, like, how quickly this board does things compared to other boards that I'm on. I should mention those two things as well, and not those boards do fine too, but this one is just a little bit different. So I'm on the Community Economic Development Board. There, I've been on that board for almost, it's changed a few times, but pretty much since my time up here at serving as the park manager at East Canyon, as well as Commissioner Fackrell helped me out with the acronym ATAB, Active Transportation Advisory Board. Did I get that?
Yep, that's correct.
Okay, perfect, yep. And then a few other various subcommittees on as well, just helping out too. And I can tell you, it's just been a great pleasure to be able to help out Morgan as a whole. I really love the community. And you know, just talking about a little bit, going back to the presentation about with UDOT, as you guys can remember, last year we had a huge fire up by East Canyon, right? Some of the things that people don't really think about is what's going to happen on that next rainstorm. Well, the next rainstorm, the big one that we had, it flooded out Highway 66 significantly, where there was material and stuff in the road. All it took was one quick call to UDOT, and they had their trucks up there moving the debris out of the way just like that. So, yeah, I obviously want to thank those guys because they help me, you know, they help, you know, park folks get to the park pretty much all through the year. It's great to have them as well. Okay, sorry, I'm taking too much of your time. So we'll roll through here. One of the things that we really wanted to stress as we come as a board is to obviously inform all of you of what our progress is, what we're working on. And our hope is to meet with you hopefully about every quarter to give you updates on the process or the progress that we're making. One of the things I wanted to stress to you right off the top of the bat is really just kind of go over the Utah Code. It's 17-31-8. It gives the breakdown of what the purpose is of our Tourism and Tax Advisory Board. I'll just read it. It's in, I think, 4 Section B. It's each Tourism Tax Advisory Board shall advise the county legislative body on the best use of revenues collected from the tax allowed under Section 5912-603, which is the transient room tax, essentially, by providing the legislative body with a priority of listings proposed expenditures based on projects available and available tax revenue supplied to the board by the county legislative body on an annual basis. Essentially, with our efforts, we want to kind of go a little bit deeper in that, trying to find out what's kind of some of the best bits for our county when it comes to tourism. We think with the group that we've assembled, we've got a good idea of some ideas and processes and things we'd like to see here in the county, and hopefully advise you all with our expertise on what some of the best things to do, with obviously your blessing as we move forward with a lot of our advice that we want to give to you. So for the updates here, I'll turn back over to Donna so she can give you some more information.
Okay, so we've come together, the local experts and contributors in the tourism industry in Morgan County. We've come together as a newly formed Tourism Tax Advisory Board to research and understand our roles and responsibilities as volunteers, to review the TRT collection, to outline our goals and objectives, and to discuss grant and marketing opportunities for the county. We were awarded the Utah Office of Tourism's Destination Development Strategic Planning Grant with branding and marketing that the county expended $32,000 on. So Utah Office of Tourism matched that $32,000, so that's $64,000 that is currently working on some development and progress. We have had our introductory meetings with both consulting firms, Caraggio Group and Hub, and we've got a high-level timeline, basically, and we're working on scheduling the next meeting within the next couple of weeks, barring spring break and all of that. But the rough timeline we're looking at is to have a strategic plan for destination development, including the branding and marketing, by about October, sometime in the fall. We were awarded the Rural Part B grant for $100,000 for a conference, retreat center, and outdoor classroom at East Canyon State Park. In February, we applied for a technical planning grant from the National Park Service Community Assistance Program for river and outdoor recreation master plan development. The Big Mountain Event Center planning and permitting is in process. We presented to the Northern Utah Chamber Coalition to apply for $1.3 million for Big Rock Campground and Mormon Flats Recreation Area. And I understand from Chris that we're getting bumped up pretty high in that priority list. We presented to the Utah Film Commission and provided a site tour of the entire county. And to so many more efforts that, you know, you'll get bored with the details, but I just want you to know that all of us have volunteered many, many hours to do some research, and we hope to have many more bullet lists that are like $100,000, $1 million, you know, that kind of stuff. That's what we're going for, right? We really want to help diversify our county's tax base by improving and increasing tourism in the county. Does anybody have anything else that I missed that you'd like to touch on for now?
Thank you. We appreciate all that the TTAB board does. Recognize that it's volunteer hours doing it, which is a sacrifice for you and your families and businesses, so thank you for doing that. And we look forward to many more exciting things to come. Thank you again, and thanks for being willing to come and give us an update on where you're at.
Yeah, and I was going to say, do you all have any questions for us as we...
Great question.
I don't have a question, but I want to just do a statement. Just so that everybody in the county and everybody that's here, we can improve on getting more tax dollars in on economic development through this board. And that's the goal. I mean, last year we brought in $90,000. There's other counties that have gone from $100,000 up to $500,000 and on upward from that, just based upon a TTAB board. So I'm appreciative of what they're doing. I'm appreciative of what, I mean, we're doing lots. There's more than just these items that they've talked about. And the historical, the historical society, you know, because you're working with them, and they got that grant, right, for the restoration of the old train station, which falls right along with the tourism. And so those are some of the things that are happening, and I just want to say thank you.
Thank you. I do have one more comment, too, in regards to that. And with these different boards that each of us are participating on, we're able to collaborate with the different organizations and committees in the county and able to work together and identify areas where there may be working in opposite directions and focus our efforts where we can make progress by working together and collaborating with everybody and all the efforts. So.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, moving to action item number one. This is Mr. Darrell Rupp, discussion decision. Along with Commissioner Fackrell on the Morgan Valley Car Show, requesting a $500 donation and to waive fees for use of the fairgrounds facility.
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Kurt Bryant. We represent the Morgan Valley Car Show. We'd like to thank you for your support and help last year in our event. It's an event that we try and tie the community into, to try and benefit the community, benefit businesses in the community. And we thank you for your help last year. We are here to ask for your help again for this upcoming year as far as the waiver of fees and the use of your facility again over the Morgan County Fairgrounds, as well as piggybacking on your insurance policies as the same as last year.
One thing that Kurt didn't mention, you're in conjunction with the truck pulls.
We are working in conjunction with the truck pulls. It'll be a separate event, same timetable, same day. We will be working together. The Lions Club will be taking care of the food for both events throughout the day. We will move in typically from about 7 until 2 p.m. Their event starts about 5 or 6 p.m. We'll go through the evening.
Can you remind us the date on that?
June 18th.
Thank you.
And their plan is to do it every year.
Correct.
And we want Mike's father's fire engine there.
Make some noise. I will note that last year's event was very well attended. I was impressed. There was a lot of folks that showed up from outside of the county as well, which is great for businesses in the county because those folks spent some money here. So we really appreciate that. And appreciate the work of the volunteer group that puts it together every year. So thank you very much to all of you.
Did we check into the possibility of adding them as an additional insured on the policy?
I did. So this was an email that I received from the CEO of USIP, which stands for Utah County's Indemnity Pool. And he indicated that he was unaware of Morgan County purchasing a separate policy for this event in the past. I think that we also acknowledged that at the last meeting. And he says if the county purchases a special event policy, they can possibly cover the other party as additional insured on that policy. This would be purely an extra expense to the county as you are covered for the, as you, the county, are covered for the event through USIP. However, USIP can only cover the county. There is no way for any other entity to piggyback on the county's coverage. If the car club is sued related to the event, there would be no coverage available to them. So that was his answer. I can look into what the cost would be for the event coverage if you'd like, but it wasn't something that was done last year. I think that was a misunderstanding.
Actually, we did do it last year because we became a part sponsor of that. We waived the fee for the insurance last year.
But that's separate from adding them as an insured. So we can waive the insurance requirement, but that's a separate issue than what I just explained.
Okay. We have enough special events going on in the county. I think it would definitely benefit us to see what costs would be for that special event coverage, in my opinion.
I agree.
And you indicating that you'd like me to see if it would be special event coverage for any special event or what the cost would be per
So it event. Sounds like we're already insured as the county for special events.
As the county,
as the county. Our county use of coverage covers the county for any special event that occurs within the county.
Correct. Yeah.
But are you wanting to have him look at a special event policy to which we could add entities like the car club?
Yes, exactly what your USIP representative stated. Like I definitely want to see what that would
be. The liability, what give me a scenario.
Oh, it's probably slip and fall type of liability. If somebody's at the car show and one of the really cool things last year, there was a guy with this old motor that spinned this thing that made, he was making snow cones. And if a kid stuck his hand in that thing while it was spinning, breaks his arm, then that's a liability issue. He'd probably have individual, so when lawyers take that, they sue everybody. They'd sue the county, they'd sue the car club, and they'd sue the individual that was running the thing.
So do we have, we're insured.
And we're
do
insured
you guys carry insurance?
We don't. Last year, we basically, it was our understanding that we
were piggybacking on our insurance.
And I don't know that, are you set up as an official club? I mean, are you a legal entity? I don't think you are. Right?
They're not. They're just.
So that being the case, I don't know that there's an insurance policy that's going to cover
something
that doesn't exist as an entity, which I think is why last time we said it's covered under the county's insurance because we're sponsoring the event.
It wouldn't cover the individual, though, that was.
Gotcha.
And so if they had a separate, their own umbrella policy or something.
Yeah, but each of the parties in the display that are displaying a car probably have some policy that would respond. Either
there's a waiver we have signed when they pulled in.
Yeah, but.
But as far as adding them individually or as a group, it's not covered under our policy.
So since they are not a group, but just a bunch of citizens, of the county, I mean, how can they go and get insurance? I mean, Napa could go and get it for their own business.
They would have to talk to their insurance.
But they're not, I mean, each one of them are a different
individual. That's right. So they'd have to talk to their insurance agent and or their attorney to see
what type of
coverage they could do. But if
that's the case, we probably don't have anybody you go to the fair. It's a fairgrounds. Or you get the horse shows that are there. How do we cover that?
The county is covered through our policy. But the individuals that are, so the motocross event, he had his own coverage.
The presenter has their own coverage.
So should we make them a county-based event like the fair?
My recommendation would be no, but I'm not the decision maker.
Well, why wouldn't you? Just out of curiosity.
Because of the extra liability it brings onto the county.
Well, can we see what it would cost?
I'm just curious. I can see what it costs.
He's making a recommendation. Well, let's see. Let's at least check into it.
Yeah. Do we let them go ahead with their event or not?
Well, I think they can go ahead as long as they understand they're not piggybacking on the county's insurance because that's not allowed under our policy as currently written. So I just wanted to make that clear so that it sounds like last year they thought they were, but they weren't. According to our insurance CEO.
Well, and the other question.
excuse me, if I may, my name is Daryl Ruff, and we've done this with the city 1 year, and we've done it with the county 1 year so far. If we're organized as a volunteer committee under the direction of the county, and we're organizing an event in the county's behalf, are we not covered through the county's insurance policy? Isn't it the event covered by the county's liability insurance?
Not according to the president of our insurance company.
Now, the president of the CEO. Insurance company, didn't the president of the insurance company say that if you want a separate policy,
then
for
the county
event,
could pay for it.
Right.
No.
But the county has events throughout the year which are covered by its current policy. Why is it that this event can't be just another county event that is covered by the existing policy?
I think that goes to Commissioner Fackrell's suggestion.
Yeah, it's the assumption in the argument that the Morgan Valley Car Show is a committee organized by the county for the purpose of putting on a county-sponsored car show. And I don't know that that's the case. Could it be?
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. That's what we're asking for.
And maybe it should be
for
insurance purposes.
For that type of relationship with the county so that we can do it. Because frankly, I've done the research on insuring, getting liability insurance for this kind of event. It's prohibitive. So if, and we're certainly not going to assume the risk as individuals when what we're trying to do is benefit the community. And so that the event would simply not be able to take place.
Yeah, this is a not-for-profit event by any means.
It's not for profit at all.
I don't see this as any different from the 4th of July activities that we put on in our facility. We don't require the Chamber of Commerce to come in with insurance for that, and they organize that. Or the Morgan County Fair, which we put on ourselves, but you know, we use volunteer efforts to do that.
Or the junior, it's under our insurance.
But there's two different issues. There's the request to waive the insurance requirement under the fairgrounds lease arrangement. We're happy to do that. But that leaves, according to USIP, that leaves this group uninsured unless they become a committee organized by the county for putting on a county-sponsored car show. Is that
I would have to clarify
stated?
With him specifically with regard to that. I think that would be the assumption based on how the others, but we also might look into whether the chamber is covered, because maybe that's a false assumption, just like this was last year, and we'd want to address that as well. What he was saying is that if we are doing a special event policy, it would be an extra cost that the county would pay, and I can ask what that cost would be, and I can follow up with these other discussions of what if we did create a county car show, and potentially that would be covered under our policy. But I don't think, as it's currently organized, I wouldn't say that qualifies as a county covered event.
We probably should ask about fair and all that stuff, right? Is that a special event?
But that is put on by the county. So that's what they're requesting, or maybe what
puts on the 4th of July, we have no live, I mean.
So instead of being the Morgan County Fair Board, they would be the Morgan County Car Show Board. Car and Tractor Show, or whatever we call it, right?
Are there any other special events that fall in the same category? Or is this the only one? I guess if it's the only one,
the 4th of July is the only other one that I can think of.
And is this the only event you guys do?
Is this horse show?
So it's not you travel around.
Hometown Christmas, the city.
Just a Morgan County event.
Typically organizing the 4 events.
And there's 4 events with the chamber, the golf.
I don't know what the chamber does for
insurance. Yeah, I don't think they do anything. They come here and ask us the same thing.
Just to use the facility.
So let's look into both of those questions. In the interim, I mean, if you're ready for a motion,
yes,
I'm happy
please.
To make one. I would move that we approve the Morgan Valley Car Show of June 18th 19th, 2022. The county provided a $500 donation with respect to the advertising of the car show and for other purposes in putting it on. And that would be the extent of the motion at this time.
I'll second that.
Okay. We have a motion and a second to approve the Morgan Valley Car Show June 18th, 2022 and the $500 donation through Morgan County. We will look into insurance to make sure we figure out how to get that taken care of one way or the other.
Thank you, because thanks. Of course it's as important to us as it is to you, because we don't want to go into the event carrying that kind of liability as individuals and businesses.
Thank you. We need to vote on the motion though, sorry.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we need to
got derailed a little bit. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, motion passes. Now,
as far as the donation, what we've been doing is as they get a bill, we've been taking that bill and having it covered, and it comes out of that $500.
Is the source of funds just the general fund?
So in the past, we did it from economic development.
I would say
general fund is just fine.
Blaine?
Yeah. It's $500.
Should it be a budget item rather than a donation if we're to be considered a committee under the direction of the county?
If that happens, then yeah.
Then we'll need
then
to adjust
have
to make it a budget item. Correct.
Yeah. So that's an option, too. So as far as I was wondering if it could go under tourism.
I'm sure it could.
So let's take it from the tourism tax. Okay.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Sure appreciate it. It was a great event last year.
Yes, it was.
I think we should.
Better this year.
That's what we expect every year.
Okay, moving to action item number two, Mr. Lance Evans, a proposed amendment to the Springview Phase 7A, combining lots 726 and 727, and creating an emergency egress parcel located at 6387 Shoreline Drive in Mount Green, Utah.
Good evening. The two items we have this, which is Plat 7A amendment, and it relates a lot to Plat 7B preliminary plat. That's the next item. So there'll be a little overlap, but we do need to be two separate items. The first is a request. Well, let's talk about the area in case you guys aren't aware. So this is Cottonwoods, Mount Green Elementary, and then 7B or 7A is these lots. They're planted here last year. They're taking these two lots right here and amending them. And they will provide a secondary access with the new road to 7B, which is this location. Goes up, butts up against large property owners to the east. Northside Creek development is here with the lake going forward. Zoomed in, the zoning is Rural Residential 1, PRUD, or PUD, in these two lots to create a one larger parcel and then an open space parcel that will have a fire apparatus road constructed in it, and that will provide secondary access in this area. It's way easier to see, so I'm going to go do that.
So they'll actually be able to put a house, one house on this.
Yes, we're going to take two lots and then move it to just one.
Okay.
So this is the actual plat amendment. It will be this area here. There's a new emergency egress parcel. This lot will be a buildable lot. And then the orientation changes, but this will be the 20-foot access easement. Built to hold 75,000 pound apparatus. It's been approved and reviewed and approved by the Mountain Green Fire Chief. He is okay with it to serve number one on this plat amendment. So this is the plat amendment, is taking these two lots, creating this one larger lot that will have this road through. Any questions on that?
So is that road that it connects to there, that will be the main access into this phase of the subdivision?
No, will just be an emergency access only.
No, the other road that...
So this is Silverleaf to the south.
Okay, the other on the north end there? Is that the north?
Yeah, exactly. Very well. So this is Silverleaf. Uh-huh. This will be the through street.
That's the main access to the new phase.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, so the emergency access just connects to that road, basically.
Correct. Well, it'll connect to that road, but this road then loops as well.
Oh, gotcha.
So this is a whole looped road.
Okay. So there's two accesses really still just through that other phase, it appears.
There. So there's the emergency access. That is emergency only, satisfied the access requirements for the code. And so that's the first, that's that by the memo. Pretty straightforward. Any questions on that?
That those lots have not been sold. They're still under the developer's ownership, I assume.
It's here if you'd like to hear from them, or I can answer any questions for you. Planning Commission reviews and is recommending approval.
Any questions?
I didn't have any.
Okay. I think we ought to treat these as two separate motions where we've got two separate items here. Is that what your intent was?
Yeah, do you want to continue the presentation and then you'll do two motions when I'm done, or do you want to knock this one?
I mean, I'm okay with taking a motion on item A and then moving to item B, if that's okay with the commissioners. Okay. Any motion on item A?
I'll make a motion that we approve Springview Phase 7A combining lots 726 and 727 and creating an emergency egress parcel. Based on the findings and conditions listed in the staff report dated March 15th, is there finding conditions about that on that in that report, Lance?
Yes.
Okay, so based on the findings and conditions listed in the staff report dated March 5th, 2022.
March 15th?
March 15th, thank you.
Yeah. I'll second it.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to approve proposed amendment to Springview Phase 7A combining lots 726 and 727 and creating an emergency egress parcel. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Okay, let's move on to item B.
Item B is sorry, 25 single-family lots with 8.8 acres of open space. Obviously, a continuation of 7A with the looped road. This is the open space area here.
And that's going to be designated forever, open space?
So they can't come back in 5 years and say, I want
to. Well, they can only come back and request to do a plat amendment, but there would be no basis for it. This approval is based on the Cottonwoods Development Agreement. They haven't asked to come back and replant any of the other open space in this area, so it's part of their open space requirements in that development agreement.
And they own all this land right now?
Correct.
Okay.
So it's not in conjunction with somebody else, such as the Wilkinsons or anything else?
That is correct.
Okay. Just making sure.
This is the application on this property.
Okay. Okay.
And they own the property within the platted boundary.
Okay.
That strip between Silverleaf and 7B, kind of that triangle going out. They don't own that. Is that correct, Skyler? Am I?
Where are we at? They don't know what?
That triangle shaped area.
Can you put it back up?
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So the applicant is proposing phase 7B, this area.
Okay.
Which they own and have rights to develop. It is in the Cottonwoods Development Agreement, which requires, that sets the lot size and the areas. 7A provided a park that was also part of that development agreement that's being constructed over here. And that was through the 7A flat. 7B is this area. And this is part of the open space requirement. There will be trail put through here, which is part of also the development agreement.
And who's in that agreement, who's responsible for maintaining any trails?
The HOA is scattered.
Okay.
I'd be happy to just add a little bit of clarity. My name is Skyler Gardner, the representative for Cottonwood Springview, the property owner. Excuse me. There is a nature trail that will surround the lots through the open space on the east and the north side, and that will be a earthen trail. So under the development agreement, the earthen trails are owned, maintained by the Homeowners Association. It's only the paved asphalt trails and other phases that are actually owned by the HOA, but maintained by the county, according to the development agreement.
And not very well.
Yeah.
Just to add a little bit of clarification on this, this is originally submitted as a single phase called Phase 7, but when we submitted phase, we divided it into two. Phase 7A was 29 lots, and the International Fire Code requires once you exceed 30 lots on a single point of access, you have to have a second means of egress. So that's first point of access is between Shoreline Drive and, seemed like it was zoomed out a little bit more, but between Shoreline Drive and Silverleaf Road. And now this secondary emergency access will be between Shoreline Drive and Silverleaf Road as well. It will be gated with a Knox box or some type of a crash gate on it. It will be marked as a no parking zone. And the snow removal for the emergency egress will be maintained by the Homeowners Association. In the interim, we plan to actually connect it. There's a trail along Silverleaf Road that's in Phase 7A. But we'll probably actually make a connection to that trail that leads up into the subdivision so the emergency egress road can be used both as a trail connection as well as in the event of an emergency it can function as an egress.
So on these trails, when these trails, they're owned by the Homeowners Association, do you allow public that might be visiting or whatever be able to use it, or just plain public using them?
The public can use the trails according to the development agreement. I wasn't involved with it way back then, but I understood that in exchange for the public having access to the trails, that's where the county maintenance requirement
is supposed to take care of it.
So public access was granted and the county maintained the hard surface trails only.
Only the hard surface ones, mm-hmm. Not the earthen ones?
Not the earthen ones.
Right. Okay. But we're still able to use those.
Yes. Okay. So in this phase, we are only proposing the earthen. Most likely, they'll be hiking and mountain biking trails.
Okay. Because that's a big thing now.
Yes, it's very popular. Did you have any other questions that I can?
Can we renege on that agreement?
We can propose an amendment to the development agreement, I'm sure. I know that there's quite a bit of, there's some encouragement from the Homeowners Association that they would actually like to take over ownership and full control and maintenance of it, but they have fallen into disrepair a little bit, so they could let them maybe brought up the standards before an exchange occurred, but it's a possibility through a development agreement amendment.
Sure. Oh, we might. We've got to deal with it, so we've got to look at what best to do.
And we have, starting in phase three of the Cottonwoods, this is a complete aside, but when we first started doing the trails, we did them in asphalt, and the longevity of asphalt just isn't, there's much more maintenance for asphalt. Working with Mark Miller and at the time Mike Wade, we actually switched to concrete. So now we have 6-foot wide concrete trails as the hard surface, and those are much more durable and long-lasting versus the asphalt trails that were constructed in the 2007, 8, 9 range, around in there. So
have you, in those trails, when you give them to us, have you already landscaped them to where there's trees?
Yeah, they're fully improved and landscaped.
Because the problem I see is with all the trees that you put around it, now we maintain it. Problem is the roots have gone into the middle of the trail, and they have a big molehill about a foot big, foot around, or a foot and a half, right in the middle of the trail. And so can you maybe possibly not put them as close, or not have them at all?
Well, we've actually reduced the number of trees because people like the views better than the shade of the trees, actually. So we've reduced the number of trees, but actually switching from the asphalt to the concrete has actually removed a lot of those problems. The roots come right up through the asphalt,
right,
which is where all the problems were. In the concrete sections, we actually haven't had any problems. And if there was, you could actually just much easier pull out one section of concrete and replace. replace it. But
and then cut down the tree.
Yeah.
And the roots.
Okay, any other questions for the applicant? Any questions for staff?
Let me just throw in one more thing, that this is, the lots, these lots over here, I want to get this on record, they do have building envelopes that are restricted inside due to this area. It's an active debris flow. So there's potential issues there. And so the building areas for these lots are going to be restricted to them. Stay out of that. All development, no sheds or pools or anything in that.
Yeah, that's lots 735 through 739.
Which ones are those?
Starting right here. So this line, this irregular line here, this is the actual back property line. But they will only be allowed to build structures in front of this debris, the identified debris flow area.
And the envelope still allows for that, right?
Yeah, we're setting the envelopes to match the debris flow area because the alternative was to actually mitigate up on the hillside the debris flow area, and it was turning into very large detention basins, which started to become unfeasible. So instead of detaining them up on the hillside, we decided to mitigate them by avoidance. So we're moving the building pads in front of the debris flow area. So, and Lance did catch that in the review, and so our final plat will have identified building pad areas on 735 through 739.
So how do we make sure that the a person that buys the property, the initial one, but then they decide to sell it and a new person moves in and they take over that and they don't know that that's an area they can't put a building, how are we going to prevent that?
Well, I don't know how I can prevent people from totally knowing. They'll be notified, it'll be on the plat notes, mm-hmm. and the building envelopes, and it'll be platted that way, so those lots will show those building envelopes are restricted in the restricted area.
Okay.
It'll be the homeowner's, future homeowner's responsibility to also
adhere to that.
To look at it a little bit. Okay. We'll catch it in building permit review as well.
There will also be a disclosure or an inclusion of the details of that in the covenants that are added, which would show up on a title report. So when they become the owner of the property, if they do review all of the disclosures that are included on the title report, that information would become apparent to them. So.
Okay.
And just the other conditions of approval are just that secondary access has to be in prior to any building permits being issued, has to be completed and paid. They've already recorded and had the access easement of this property here, and Skyler showed me earlier that they've realigned this. There was some concern about that jog there, and there's a drainage there. They've realigned this a little bit to combine and go with the slope. So this is the preliminary plat. When it comes back with the final plat, that will be modified, and Skyler, they've also actually split these two lots, reduced this one by 20 feet, and so that will actually be an open space area. So that trail easement going back up to the tank and to the adjacent property owner, that'll all be modified for the conditions. So we've got these conditions that the Planning Commission approved. Most of them have already been addressed, the ones that can.
So those are going to be, that's a dirt trail there then.
It is a dirt access road, and I don't know if the staff report, I don't have it in front of me, but we have, when it comes back for a final plat, you will see an access easement 26 feet wide with a parcel that's included in the open space area 20 feet wide. So that in the event that it does become a hard surface, access to the adjoining landowner or to another water tank that's to the east of this property, that section of land could be further improved. But we're not proposing any improvements with this subdivision. It would just be a access dirt track trail up to the adjoining property owner for now.
Because I noticed, and in your report, Lance, it had a 20-foot, but they amended it to be a 28-foot, and now he's saying a 26.
The condition of approval is that it be 26.
Yeah.
26. And that... I just want to keep things uniform so we don't have problems.
Okay, any other items? Okay,
that's it.
With that, we'll look for a motion on action item 2B.
I move to approve the Cottonwood Spring View Phase 7B subdivision preliminary plat application 21.060 located at approximately 6400 South Wasatch Back Drive in Mountain Green area based on the findings and with the conditions listed in the staff report dated March 15th, 2022.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second to approve the proposed preliminary plat for Cottonwood Spring View Phase 7B. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Okay, action item number 3, Zach White, County Treasurer, discussion decision with HR.
To reclassify the DMV employee to correctly classify her to match the previous DMV person's classification. So she was not classified correctly to begin with, so it was correct without mistake to put her in the correct classification.
So this document has a different title, moving from DMV Tech to Deputy Treasurer Assistant. Is that something you're asking to do too, or are we just reclassifying the DMV tech to a different classification?
Well, she's also getting cross-trained to be deputy treasurer as well, but.
So do we have a job description written for deputy treasurer assistant? Okay. So we need to decide if that's what we're doing or if we're talking about, because we've got, in my mind, two different items here. One is the reclassification of a DMV tech, the other is moving to a different job title and potential description for that.
So an additional job title or different?
Well, it looks like it's different, but I guess it's an additional job title because we don't currently have that job title or description.
Yeah, that might have been
is that correct?
I don't know what we call her. I'd have to go and talk to other treasurer's offices that have the DMV in their office and see what they call them. I don't know what their typical job title is, but
based on the emails I reviewed, this title would be something that would happen in the future that could increase the grade if I was reading the emails correctly. And so this is just a reclassification of the DMV position solely. But that's just based on the emails that I reviewed.
That was what my understanding was, too. I didn't know there was anything.
Well, and that's why I ask, because the form has the new job title.
The form doesn't exactly match the email, because it's going from the 11 to the 13. The email was talking about adding the other positions and moving it to a grade 14.
So then, which one is correct? The form?
So as far as this, we're going to reclassify her to classify her correctly to fix the county's mistake for classifying her incorrectly. The other thing was a proposal to cross-train her, and I feel that she's done everything that she needs to be able to take on that other responsibility. Then we would discuss that one at a further date. But this one's just reclassifying her to classify her correctly.
I have a concern that we've talked about before. In some of our discussions with our former HR people, they discussed that the pay was correct for the position she was hired for. And that the only thing we did not do was with the cost of living. So I can see moving up to the cost of living and allowing her to have that one because it was not done originally. But to reclassify her, I say that we do that at budget time. Because we do not, I mean, we budgeted so much, and there's been positions that retired afterwards that you had a higher budget. And I think just because we had, I mean, we've got the clerk's office, we've got your office, we've got, I don't know who else's office right now, but we've got extra money that we budgeted for. But right now, I don't want to see a property tax increase to pay for all of these increases. And so for now, if it's a matter of us keeping employees, And that's a different subject. But I think that the position was correctly classified when she took the job. And the classification that you're trying to get now is a different subject, and therefore, if we have to classify it differently, then I think we need to make sure that she's at that 6-month point, and under the current handbook, then at that point she would come up for a review to take care of that. And that review, I think we need to either set up a review board or whatever we need to do, because under his situation, you can't.
So I think there's a misunderstanding of what it is. So the previous DMV person has their classification, and the classification is based off of the job description. The job description has not changed, so the classification should not have changed. So she was classified incorrectly. So we need to continue with that same classification and do that. So that's why I'm saying we need to reclassify her, because the job description didn't change. And that's what...
Julie, do you have the records of the previous DMV employee readily accessible? Just want to confirm what classification that was. Yeah, what grade it was and what the job description was. Was it DMV tech? Was it DMV supervisor? What was it? And what was the grade? Okay.
She definitely was listed under supervisor. Is that what we're talking about?
We're talking about Jenny.
Yeah.
Maybe Gwen could tell us.
And do we know what that grade was previously?
Yeah, I've got one letter here. 14. Was Jim.
The grade was 14. Okay.
And I didn't think you were trying to put her in a supervisor role, so that's why I went to 13.
Okay, so do we have, but that was under a DMV supervisor. What we're talking about here is a DMV technician. Mm-hmm. What's the job description and grade associated with a DMV technician?
She was put at an 11, and we're trying to get her up to a 13, which would kind of create a new position. Am I saying that correctly? We've been dealing with this a long time, so I might be getting a little bit.
So I'm not understanding.
Yeah,
that.
She was an 11, or there was an 11 or a 15 in the existing pay grade system.
Okay, the 15, I'm assuming, was supervisor, 11 was technician.
She should never have been an 11.
So if, yeah, so
we're trying to get her up to 13.
The position wasn't even on our pay scale. So when we adopted the pay scale, we put her at a random grade, which was not the grade that Jenny would have been at if we had this policy, if we had that pay scale. So based off of what Jenny would have been, you take that same
okay,
exact.
But Jenny was classified as a supervisor. The current employee is a supervisor or not a supervisor?
The job description is what defines that. So the job description didn't change.
So, okay, the job description didn't change.
Yeah, she does everything that Jenny did.
So you're wanting her to be a 15?
Whatever, I don't know what our pay scale says, but whatever is correct is what we need to do.
So is this a supervisory position or not?
No, but she has no one under her. That's why she's not a supervisor. If she had someone under her, she would be, but she's not.
And did the previous employee that operated DMV, was that a supervisor position, Gwen?
She's classed that way, yes.
Okay. So it sounds like what we're talking about, you said there wasn't any position besides a supervisory position, job description wise?
There was either a supervisor description or, like on talking about on the pay scale?
Just the job description itself.
Job description was the same.
Okay, and the job description, it provided for supervisory responsibilities?
Yes, and she
both old and new.
Teach us. She's been training us because we are now cross-training and merging two different offices, so she's having to train and teach us how to do it. So technically you could say that she is a manager or a supervisor because she does have to train and teach and manage us on how to do the DMV functions.
Okay, so I guess what I'm getting at is, I need to understand what the job description is that we're talking about here, and then how that translates to the pay scale and the grade. You know, is the grade supposed to be 15, or is there supposed to be a different grade? That pay grade should be determined based on factors of work that's been done previously to survey other positions of similar type and determine what the pay should be. Not just we want them at a certain grade. There should be something behind that, and we've had that discussion in the past. So I guess my question is, we're talking about reclassifying from what's currently at a grade 11 to a 13, correct? Based on the form, okay? So what work did we do to determine what a 13 should be? Does that make sense? And if this particular position fits into a 13, or should it be a 15, or should it be a 14, or whatever? What have we done to determine that? And I don't know if that's a question more for Julie or for you or for both of you, but well, that's what I'm trying to get at.
That's why I'm doing the research to kind of look at all of it, because we feel like some things were done wrong. But in this case, because she's not supervising anyone, I had a hard time asking for her to be a 15. But an 11 seemed too low, since she does all the same things that the supervisor did. The only difference is she's not supervising. But she is cross-training other people to do her job now. So how, like you said, however you want to look at that. So I came up with what felt like a fair increase in pay and grade was to a 13 instead of a supervisory position. Then that gives her room to grow in the future. That's how I just came up with the 13. But we could hold off on, like he's saying, hold off on the grade classification until we get that fixed, and then just give her the increase in pay right now, if you can agree with that. Because it, you know, she's at 1536 right now.
And that's where I was saying, you know, give her the increase, the COLA increase for now, just the COLA.
And give
her
more time.
And then and give us more time.
Which we should have done. We should have brought that description.
Yeah.
So the COLA increase is not this amount that we're talking
that's
here.
That's correct.
COLA increase is 4%.
Right. And that's already happened.
5%. 5% is what we get.
That's already happened.
Was that already part of this?
No. Well, I don't know about that.
I don't know, because probably... She was hired right around the time of that, so she probably didn't get the COLA.
No, she didn't get the COLA.
Oh. So she should get the COLA. We can do that. I mean, I can certainly get behind that. I think we just need to have a clear job description. If we're going to have a pay grade associated with a job, we need to have a job description for it that matches that, so that we know what we're agreeing to. And I don't think just saying, well, I'm trying to get somewhere in between is justification enough. Because I feel like that's going to open up issues with other departments that are going to say, well, I feel like I want them in an increase. Let's come in and say, let's reclassify them. But whether just or not, I'm not, you know, I'm sure the employee deserves much more than, you know, just and does a great job. But we need to have those descriptions, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. Commissioners, any other thoughts? Okay, so I guess the question now before us, though, is in terms of doing a COLA increase, I guess it's just an administrative item and we can do that. We don't have to have that as part of our agenda notice that we're intending to do a COLA increase for one employee. Would you agree with that?
I'm going to ask Julie. That's not part of the ordinance that we were looking at. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, a COLA is not an ordinance item.
Yeah.
It's okay. So that's something we would be free to do now.
Jack,
should
can
we choose to?
Sorry, you asked if we had questions and I didn't respond, so I apologize, Chair. Employee number 982. When was their hire date?
I don't know. Then based off of employee numbers, what's their name?
Well, we don't want to disclose that.
Yeah, the employee that.
Okay, Susan, I don't know. She was hired, what, November?
November.
Okay. Well, so that's weird that we didn't give the COLA. I thought we gave it to everybody that were currently employed.
We did not give it to her.
Okay.
So I think we need to raise it just to the COLA amount for now until they get it figured out.
Okay.
Is the polo 4%, is that what you're saying?
5%. It was 5%.
Or 5%. 5%.
So, Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we increase the salary for employee number 982 by 4%, representing the cost of living and adjustment.
Or
5%. 5% is what we gave for COLA.
5%.
So 70 is 77.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, we have a motion. Do we have a second? Okay, we have a motion, a second, to make the COLA adjustment for employee 982. Effective immediately, or are we
make it effective January 1st?
Thank you. Backdating that to January 1st. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion passes. All right. Anything else regarding that employee 982, or shall we move on to employee 1003?
So, just to be clear, for the action item for Zach is to get. And Julie is to get a job description of this new position.
Correct.
So do you want the new position or what her position is like now?
Well, I think that's what you need to determine. Are we talking about reclassifying this as a new position? Is it in fact a new position? In my correspondence with our former HR folks, they said no, it doesn't qualify as a new position.
Right.
Just because somebody's cross-trained in another field doesn't mean it's a new position. It just means that they sometimes do a different job description.
Completely different department.
Correct. It's still not a new position. Now, Julie may disagree, and the commissioners may disagree, but that was the information that I got from our former HR folks. Okay.
So
now, that being said, that doesn't mean that we can't have a job description for the current position, and it sounds like we don't have a job description for the current position, so I would recommend that we do that. But you could do both if you want, if you so choose, and that can come before us. So that's up to you to determine.
So if it's not, so what about the current job description? If she's not classified correctly based off her current job description, so can we update that?
Then I think we need to have that discussion again. That needs to come back here. We need to have the form filled out correctly with the current job title. And we need to have a description for that, and then we can talk about what that means, if in fact that needs to be reclassified.
But based on the email we received, she was classified correctly.
That's correct.
Correct. According to the former HR folks, the classification was correct at the time of hire. So do with that information what you will. You know, you can make a determination on that. But that's my understanding. Okay, anything else on that one before we move to the next item? Employee number 1003. This is the 10% that was previously.
Do we really have to, I mean, on that, does it have to come before all of us as a legislative item?
Well, this isn't a legislative item.
Okay, all right.
It's administrative, but I guess it does because it is an increase in salary, so all of those do have to come before us. Although this is policy driven, I mean the policy allows for.
We'd like to change it so you don't have to.
Yeah, we'll see.
And there are administrative items that come before the commission as well, so it's kind of confusing because there are certain administrative items that can be handled not in an open meeting, but all the action items are administrative items. The only legislative items on our agendas are the public hearings. And so that can be a little confusing. So there are certain administrative items that always come here.
Okay.
There are others that are more operational that can be handled unless our ordinance says otherwise outside of a public meeting.
And I actually agree with that comment from Commissioner Fackrow. I know at Weber County, I mentioned actually Commissioner Wilson a little bit earlier. I don't ever remember specific employees and their adjustments and why not. I don't ever remember that coming before in a public meeting.
So. And the only reason this is because there was an ordinance passed that Julie found that requires it. And so I don't know what happened that made that change, but that was one of the things in our work session that we wanted to potentially address and change back in a legislative manner.
From my perspective, as long as we're not increasing the budget, it doesn't need to be discussed. Now, if we're talking about increasing a budget to accommodate it, then it should come before a public meeting like this,
right,
not just an administrative meeting.
I mean, neither of these cases would be increasing the budget.
Yeah,
right,
exactly.
Right.
But we're currently bound by the current policy, which says it does come here.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean we couldn't change that policy moving forward, and we probably ought to discuss that. So. Okay, questions, comments on this portion? Or is there a motion?
Mr. Chair, I'll make a motion that we increase the salary for employee number 1003 to $19.59 per hour effective February 7th, 2022, based upon the 10% increase in base pay given at the time of hire and pursuant to our current policy.
So I guess I do have a question. Was that in this?
This thing that we got earlier today?
It isn't.
It's not, but it is based on our current policy.
It's based on current policy.
That
from experience, years of experience, 10% increase is allowable.
And so this is an administrative item that if it checks the box of our current policy, then you would approve it. But it was also listed in our work session. And if the commission wanted to change the current policy, that would be a legislative decision, because then it wouldn't be checking the box. It would be whatever you felt was appropriate for the county.
So what you're telling me is basically, since the boxes are checked, you have to vote yay.
You don't have to, but I would highly recommend it, because otherwise there's potential liability.
So then why is it brought before here if everybody has to vote yay?
Well, you don't have to. You still have a choice to vote yay or nay. But the reason it's coming is because a prior council passed an ordinance that said any changes have to come before the prior council and now the commission. And that's another policy that we would like to legislatively change.
Okay. Well,
now we have no choice.
Tie my hands.
Yeah. Can't do anything.
Okay, we have a motion. Do we have a second?
Sorry.
I'll second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second to make the 10% wage change as currently listed in the policy for employee 1003. All those in favor of the motion?
Aye.
Aye.
Can we abstain?
If you want to. You can.
No, not yet. I haven't voted.
Oh, okay. Commissioner Facco, do you vote aye or nay?
Well, if it's one of those things we have to do anyway, and she's already been hired at that, there's nothing you can do, so I have to vote aye. I don't agree with it, though.
Can I make a quick comment?
Sure.
I know we've already voted, so I just want...
One second, though.
Yes.
Motion passes based on the votes. Okay.
For those that are watching, for those that are here, I hope you realize and understand how much every dollar means to us. You know, we're really trying to do our best to manage this correctly. At the same time, I read an article earlier today that said the Park City Mountain Resort has a minimum wage. They're bumping up their minimum wage to $20 an hour. So it's hard. We want to make sure policies are followed correctly. That doesn't mean at all that these employees are doing a great job, and it actually doesn't mean they deserve the pay at all. I think what we're trying to figure out and make sure we're doing right is following our policies and procedures and standards correctly. I think if anybody's been noticing, I almost think it's been every commission meeting since the first year we've had something come up with employees. So it's been a lot to work with, a lot to deal with, and we're doing the best we can. That's all I have to comment on.
Now, this didn't include back pay to January, right?
It's February 7th.
February 7th.
Which she's already been paid because of my policy.
So it's already been in effect, is what you're saying. There's not going to be a back pay. Okay. Moving to action item number 4. Commissioner Fackrell and discussion decision on fee schedule.
Actually, it was more Matt and I discussing with Zach this fee schedule that we brought, or that he brought up last time, and he was not here, and so we went through it with him, and basically we determined an amount that we had questions on before.
There's only one other update that's that I have to say about that one. Clayton, the animal control officer, he said that he would like to not do the increase to the lifetime tag and take it to $5 instead of $10.
Why?
That was just his recommendation. I just told him I would give the recommendation.
Okay, I
don't... Perhaps in an effort to get more licenses? I don't know.
I think he was just kind of more thinking it's kind of your benefit of being elderly and he's trying to help.
Oh, gotcha, because the lifetime is...
Yeah,
lifetime.
He's 60 or older, so the lifetime of your dog.
I thought it was 65.
Or whatever it is.
Okay.
To $5?
I
was
going to
say, I paid $20.
It's $10 now.
He just came to my office earlier today and asked if I would let you know that that's what his suggestion was. You can do with it whatever you want, but I told him I would let you know.
I have a thought on these fees that I think we need to explore a little bit more, particularly for our park camping fees and Bowery rental fees. We are implementing a non-resident fee for the rifle range, and I think we ought to consider the same for our parks and Boweries. And I'll tell you why, particularly for camping at the Croydon Park. I live in the area, so I see who's camping there, and the vast majority of the time it's non-county residents. And I'm okay with that, but for those who do camp and go places, you know how difficult it is to find a place to camp these days and how expensive it's become. I think we're going to see an increase in traffic on that park, and it's going to be an increased amount of county residents. And I'm concerned that our fee is so low that that's all we're attracting. And what's happening is we open up the booking dates and it gets completely booked out by non-county residents because it is so inexpensive. I mean, to take an entire group up there and camp for $100 a night is dirt cheap. I mean, you're talking a couple bucks a person. So I personally would like to see us do a non-resident fee for that as well. And probably for our other parks as well, I would like to see a non-resident fee for all of these things. And my justification behind that is that our county residents are already paying property taxes that do support these facilities. I don't think it's right for folks who don't pay those taxes to come in and reap the benefits.
Yeah, the same thing. I especially for the Milton Brewery.
Yeah, because if you
that's a deal.
You can rent the brewery for 4 hours for $40.
You just
for your information, there's a typo here.
That.
It says brewery, not Bowery. That's
yeah. Scary. It says no. I guess it was you, Zach, that did that. The brewery versus Bowery.
Bowery.
So, my personal opinion is I would like the non-resident fee to be 2 to 3 times the resident fee. Whatever the resident fee
across
is,
the board.
I think it ought to be across the board, and I think mm-hmm. we ought to have a non-resident fee across the board on everything. Even the rifle range at $50 for a non-resident, that's pretty cheap.
Isn't that for a 2 hour?
Yeah, that's for 2 hours.
That's for 2 hours.
Yeah.
But that's still fairly inexpensive. Now, I don't know, the sheriff may have an opinion on that.
Well, some of them, your records, your things like that, those are mandated by state. You wouldn't be able to do a non-resident on certain fees, like ours, it's pretty much a set.
A police report?
Oh, yeah, yeah. So we're only talking about, just for clarification, we're talking about rifle range lease, search and rescue building lease, auditorium rental, dog licenses, which there wouldn't be a non-resident for dog licenses.
Right.
Croydon Park Camping and Bowery, Enterprise Kent Smith, and Melton Bowery, and Fields at Kent Smith Park. Those are the only fees we're talking about. We're not talking about any other records fees or anything like that.
Yeah.
On this schedule for the rifle range, if that's a 2 hour time period, we ought to put that on the fee schedule.
Yeah.
Yeah. 2 hour time block.
Yeah.
I didn't put it on there just because it's currently at 2 hours and we're not changing it. So I just, that was the only reason it's not on there.
Yeah. Just to be clear. So, and I agree with the
resident.
So can we still pass it with the amendments?
Yeah, we could amend it, I think, and pass it.
Okay.
So do you just put the amounts in there and just let me know what I have to do?
I'm going to say three times the resident fee to a non-resident. Whatever our current fee is, I think a non-resident ought to pay three times that. But if you guys disagree and want it to be something different, that's fine. So if it's $40, it should be $120.
So if it's like Brandon Park, they pay $300 a night for that.
For non-resident. Correct.
Okay.
But that's not a campsite then? That's for like the whole park?
That's the whole park. Your camping, your Bowery, there's a kitchen facility and restroom facilities. I mean, even at that, it's still pretty cheap for a family. A large group.
Yeah.
You know? And typically the groups that are there are large groups. They're very large groups. So.
You just let me know what you want me to do. If it's easy.
Okay, so I think let's do it that way then.
Okay. Do you want to make a motion?
Okay, I'll make a motion that we approve the Morgan County fee schedule as amended, charging the residents the rate shown and changing the non-residents to three times the rate of a resident for the rifle range, search and rescue, auditorium, dog license. I guess we don't worry about that.
Yeah, dog license.
Police, no, we don't worry about that. Croydon Park, Camping and Bowery, Enterprise Bowery, Kent Smith Bowery, Kent Smith Fields, and Milton Brewery. Bowery.
Bowery.
Sorry.
I just have a question. How
are we going to determine? So I think in all of these cases, if somebody's going to rent the facility and come pick up keys, they need to show an identification showing
when
that they're...
When you book it online, it requires you to put your driver's license information in there with your address and driver's license number.
You're going to get cheaters.
We probably will have cheaters. We recognize that.
Yeah.
Hopefully people will be honest with us, but we probably will have people who book under somebody else's name or things like that, which...
And we can send the sheriff after them.
That's a civil issue.
Oh. So was the motion seconded?
No. The motion has not been seconded. We have a motion.
I'll second, but I have a question on the motion. Did you want to keep the lifetime dog license at $25?
I think that's a screaming deal, but I'm okay with whatever.
I agreed until if it is in fact for senior citizens that are 65 and
okay.
older,
they have their comfort dog. Okay, that's so fine.
What is that current fee?
$10.
Do we want to just leave it at 10?
Leave it at 10.
Okay. So we have an amended motion.
Why at 10? I mean, I'm a senior citizen. It's poor to see.
I know, but you're not a senior citizen.
Oh, yes, I am. Well, I understand. You're right. I'm not.
You're not.
Yeah.
So maybe the rest of their life is the cost of 1 year. That's why.
Yeah.
So
per dog.
Per dog, yeah.
Yeah.
So
it does relate to the dog, right?
Yeah, not the person.
I mean, the food is more than that.
Sure it is. Yeah.
I mean, why even have
fuel to take it to
the
vets more than that these days?
That's right.
They're on a fixed income.
Okay, my second stands as amended.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Okay, motion passes. Thank you. Okay, Commissioner Fackrell, discussion decision, disposal of surplus property countywide.
We were, Leslie and I were discussing, well, actually, I started with this, and then Leslie had some questions, and you guys received the thing that Leslie sent to you. It's on disposal of surplus property countywide, and there is a program out there that is offered by UAC. I mean, it's actually offered through public surplus .com. And they've been doing it for many, many years because I used them once. And it's an auction-based system. And we had a webinar with a guy from this. And he says, there's a benefit for all of us. It does not cost the county anything. And it can be used for real property and other property. That is, you know, like we could take a a truckload of all of the old computers, take out all the guts and sell the computer stand, you know, and those things, and we could do it as a lot sale. And I saw on the website that there was wiring that we may have pulled out of anything, and they make a pile or a big box of it, and they put it on this auction site, and surprisingly, it sells for a decent price. And it works just like, I think, eBay, but I don't know because I don't use it that much, where we can put in a reserve price and say that the bid has to be above that or we won't accept it. And it's at their discretion to the people that buy to come and pick it up or figure out how to ship it to them. And this auction goes to over 7 million people nationwide, countrywide, and it's all public surpluses, school districts, governments, all that kind of stuff. And they've got a program in it within that that would take care of like tax sales and any excess surplus property that we may want to sell. So, for instance, if we wanted to sell the corner lot over here for $400,000, you know, whatever it might be. Oh, yeah, the Milton Brewer we could sell, yeah. And so the program is basically not going to cost us anything.
Is that because there's a buyer premium? Is that how
Yes, that's what it is. It's a buyer premium. And so we set the price, we get that price.
So what do we currently use to do this?
We have nothing.
We don't have one.
We don't have anything in place.
It's been something that we've discussed and made a decision.
And so that's what we were discussing. Right. And so, so one of my proposals is that we work on a surplus property resolution later, or an ordinance, and in the meantime, we can sign up for this through UAC, which gives UAC some more money, which means it might cut our costs down, but it would pay. It's basically benefiting everybody. So, I don't know if Leslie, you have anything more you want to say?
No. Did you have a chance to look at the website? Did you go in?
Is there any concern, Garrett, with moving forward with this before we have an ordinance in place discussing the disposal? Or can we just say our policy is going to be we're going to use this until we get the ordinance in place?
Well, I think our ordinance...
state.
I mean, we currently have some kind of
it's a state ordinance.
We actually do. So that was the only thing I was going to say. It says, since we currently do not have a county code, we do have a county code. That's what we reviewed yesterday. It's just a really short county code, and it had, if you remember, personal and real property, and there were two small paragraphs.
Okay,
so we actually do have a county code. It's just not very robust.
Yeah. I mean, I just see it a benefit. I noticed the other day, and a week ago, I was in with Jeremy, and they were just taking stuff out to the dumpster. And after seeing these things on the surplus property, we could have easily boxed it all up. Maybe we would have got back into the system $50. But still, every $50 counts and helps the county. And so I'm just thinking, instead of just throwing things into the dumpster, which is what we do in every single office, instead of doing that, let's do a, you know, something where we can just take care of it through this means.
I don't think the current proposal would go against our county code, because it just says the power to dispose of surplus, obsolete, or unusable personal property held by the county is vested in the elected official over a department. And so that elected official or the county purchasing agent over a department, if there isn't an elected official over that. So that would be either the elected official or Matt as a purchasing agent, Commissioner Wilson. And then the official or agent shall declare such property as may be surplus, obsolete, or unusable, and shall dispose of said property in any manner that is deemed to be in the best interest of the public. Such disposition may be by sale, salvage, trade, donation, or disposal as appropriate. So for all of the departments that are not run by an elected official, then our purchasing agent can dispose of it through this website. All of our elected officials can dispose of it through this website. And so under our current code, I guess my suggestion would be for the commission not to adopt something that forces, because under our code, you can't do that. We would have to amend the code. But I think by broadcasting it or publishing it, like Leslie's doing, to say, hey, this is an option, then that would give every elected official or our purchasing agent another tool to dispose by sale, salvage, trade, donation, or disposal as appropriate.
Perfect. The only thing I'm worried about is I see some issues. I mean, if we don't have a policy amongst us, county-wide, and I mean the state says that policy there where each elected official can make that, I think we still need to have some kind of an overall idea as to, you know, if it's a big ticket item, say it's the fleet car that's a county, you know, that the assessor's been using, but it's us that has it, you know, what happens to that? We need to be able to dispose of it in a correct manner. And I mean, just because it's being used by a department doesn't mean it's that department's, is all I'm saying.
Well, and that's fine. I think that's another discussion, another agenda item to right. Review the code and update the code. But the agenda item we have before us tonight
is to go with you at
if we go
surplus
through this
property
program as a tool. I'd like that.
That's all it is.
That word, let's use it as a tool for our departments.
And so I think that it would
just need to be voted on, right?
I think it does need to be voted on that we're going to sign up for it.
Yeah.
But other than that, I don't, you know,
yeah,
not
think,
changing code or anything.
But it would be limited to just the purchasing agent, because the commission, I mean, the elected elected officials should use it. But under our current code, it's either, you know, Commissioner Wilson's over the department heads that aren't run by the elected officials. The elected officials are separate, and so you couldn't pass something requiring the elected officials to do it without amending the code.
Well, I don't think we're talking about requiring anybody to do it, be it our purchasing agent or our elected officials. We're
right.
Just talking about
yeah.
Using it as a tool in our tool belt. If our elected officials choose to use it, great. If our purchasing agent chooses to use it, great. And if not, that's fine too.
Okay.
So do we even need to vote on it then?
Well, maybe we don't. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know either.
Our official action to sign up for the service, at least. I feel like that probably ought to be done, that we've officially decided we're going to use this service if we choose to. I think that's...
Okay.
Yeah, because, I mean, when it works with the property taxes, you're going to have to figure that one out, because it works great with a property tax sale.
I'm sure you probably have a lot
broader
potential customer
reach.
Base on that.
Right.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion that we, as a tool, we use publicsurplus.com, sign up for that as a county, and use that as a tool to dispose of our surplus property. Then.
I'll second it.
We have a motion and a second to sign up for the public surplus online auction system. It can be used by our department.
Would you like me to
officials.
Be in charge of that, then?
Sure.
Yeah, you're in charge of that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, motion passes. All right, item number 6, we actually will postpone on this agenda. This is discussion decision on award of tourism DMO contract. That's still ongoing. We have received applicants for that. We'll be interviewing applicants and moving forward with that at a later date. Any discussion on that before we move?
Nope. Not for me.
Okay.
Thursday night.
All right, let's move to Commissioner comments. Commissioner Fackrell.
Michelle, I'm going to talk about the airport issues if you want to stick around for a second.
Commissioner Fackrell.
We had a meeting last night with the UDOT and the planners for the trails, and it's moving along.
Good.
Would you agree with that, Robert?
Yeah. Yeah, they did. It was kind of a scoping meeting, talked mm-hmm. about the different steps and so forth. So that's great.
Yeah. And as far as the website, we have got a lot of things directed correctly to the website. But the problem is now the website from the old one is going into the new one and showing all the old stuff. And so it's going to take a it's taking a coordination between Jeremy and Blue Spider Media to get that straightened out. And so anyway, forthcoming next month we'll discuss more. But I'm working on that.
Okay. With respect to the water or the airport issues, there's a total of 7 water connections at the airport. 4 of them are fully allocated. There were 3 remaining water connections that were available for the DD, EE, FF, and GG rows, and they provided sufficient water capacity to provide water service to all of the hangars that have been previously approved, as well as the Buster Del Monte, the 5-9 proposal. It is not enough water to also service the Forest Service building if they did the new building on that parcel, or to water the berm. I'm not sure that when we look at the 5-9 proposal, when it comes in, that, to me, that's not just a lease of hangar space, that's a commercial operation. And I'm not sure that they should get that remaining water share, which could potentially free up the last one for the berm.
And on that, just numbers that I was given by Mike, you might have the same information, but if you don't, it might.
What are you talking about? The remaining acre feet in water?
He said there was a remaining half acre feet. And the reason how he came up with those numbers, because the first 4 that are used, some of those are used just for one hangar itself. And he did a 5-year study to really stretch the numbers. What he said was, I became as creative as I could to fit in as many, which as a community resident, I'm a little concerned with that because I don't know if that is ever done for any developer. And I feel like he kind of, even when he was talking about the 95% confidence rate versus the 97% confidence rate, he's going off of just what they're using right now. And some of those hangars that aren't using, some of the future hangars that are going in, will most likely be using more of that water. And then just another note on the information that I received back from the landscape architect. He thought the half would be way plenty. That was a count of, I'm sure you've read the emails back and forth through the board, but that was 35 trees and 100 bush. And he also has experience. His schooling, he's done landscaping around airports and knows that there are some stipulations on there on types of trees and what you can use. By the airports, Kirk Miller, if you're familiar with him, if any of you know him, he lives in our county.
So I'm going to stop just a second. I appreciate this information, but this is commissioner comment time period. It's really not public interaction. I know we've kind of interacted a little bit. I'm not trying to squash that, but sure. I want to keep to the agenda here.
So yeah, and Mike Johansson did give me those numbers. The study he did was, so the airport, this is a while ago, went to the water company and said, we don't believe that every hangar needs a separate water connection. It will never use that amount of water. That this is typically a bathroom facility on a part-time basis that people use so they have a bathroom facility in their hangar. And so that's been in place for a number of years. And so he went back and they looked at the water usage. They did that at my request because they were talking about additional water connections. And I said, well, what they measured the usage through the meters. Let's look at the actual usage. And so they looked at the actual usage, and then he's extrapolated that to all of the additional hangars. Is there a possibility that a hangar user could use more water? Sure, but that's why he's looking at the standard deviation and figuring that out. I think the half acre should be plenty, particularly if we use a xeriscape on the berm, but he wants to see the planting and what's proposed in order to evaluate that. So then again, we're back to 5-9 and whether and how we utilize that last water one, whether the county acquires an additional water share. There is water available through Weber Basin. There's storage capacity credits that are available, and we'd have to work out the deal to acquire that and whether we do that as the county acting as the developer in that general way, we can do that, or is that a cost we pass along to a lessee of a commercial venture? With respect to the master plan, the proposals to expand to the EE, FF, and GG rows have all come before the county commission and or the county council, depending on the time frame, to do the expand the airport in that way. We've frankly already entered into lease agreements with all of these individuals to let them lease that space. The EIS, I've never seen an EIS for the airport, and I'm not aware of any requirement that an EIS be done for any development in the county, including the airport. Now, there are federal requirements with respect to certain things that occur, like the EIS that's required for the Mountain Green Interchange, but I'm not aware of an EIS requirement. There may have been one done. I've never seen it. I don't know. I heard Joe say that he thought there was one done a long time ago. The minutes of the Airport Advisory Board, I know they take them. I thought they were being posted. We should follow up to see that that's being done. The representation.
May I make a comment on the agenda or the meeting minutes? I actually received them from Julie. I gave them to Leslie. Leslie says she'd put them in a vault. So wherever that vault is, if we need to post them on the website, you got to let me know so that way I can take care of it.
I think if people want to read them, there's no reason not to post them on the website.
Okay. All right.
The citizen representation on the Airport Advisory Board is set by the county ordinance. If we want to change it, then we would need to have a request to amend and modify the ordinance to do it.
Do they have bylaws?
I've never seen actual bylaws for the Airport Advisory Board. Yeah, they may actually have them.
There was one.
I mean, it was created a long time ago.
And I think they made an ordinance based on a little bit of help from the community, correct, to help with some decisions or something?
I mean, at least the Airport Advisory Board has both not pilot and non-pilot members. I agree that we ought to consider a change order for the current work to extend whatever water line is necessary to the berm to facilitate the completion of that, so that we have a water source and we don't have to tear something up after it's been put back together. So anyway, that's just some information on the county. I'm aware of the agreement, at least the undated and unsigned copy of the agreement that's been provided. It did require the construction of a 30-foot landscape buffer, apparently what was done before was considered sufficient at the time, but it hasn't been maintained, and like I've said before, I do think we ought to put some funds towards maintaining that buffer so that it is more appealing to the residents, because right now it's just a mound with maybe three trees that have survived and some wild grass that grows on it, and my grandson tells me I ought to mow. So.
Okay. I don't have any items to discuss, Jared.
I've got just a couple. I have not got an email out, and I need to. If you're not aware, legislative session finished on the 4th. Bill of Bills came out late that night, and multiple of us commissioners got a text from lobbyists involved, but we were awarded $5 million for the Mountain Green Interchange. I believe it was stated approximately $1 million towards EIS. Well, no, actually, I think it said for EIS and preliminary engineering. I think that's what it said. Not real specifics, but we were only one of three projects stated in the state. So hiring that lobbyist firm and having them go look for dollars for us was one of the, in my opinion, better decisions we made.
Yeah.
Amazing effort by everybody involved. Glad that we were all on board with that. and to get $5 million to get that project started, and now all of a sudden moved up high on the STIP list, and to get it moving forward was
a huge win.
Phenomenal win.
It's a great investment.
I talked with a couple very, very large cities in northern Utah. They didn't get a dime, and there was plenty of monies. So that's another story. But anyways, very, very excited about that. And there's a few things with our recreation department. I don't mean to steal all Matt's thunder, because it's probably some of the stuff talking about. But
I don't have to.
Kent Smith Park. We were just talking about the expansion of the fields there, and then there was discussion on ownership of the property. Looking at our quick ownership map, which says it might not be correct, but look at it. It does say that the sewer district owns the property of that park. So I at least want to look into that. My understanding from the sewer district is years ago, they said we have a lagoon system. If we ever want to expand, we need this much space to expand again. Nowadays, we can have mechanical systems where we actually don't need that space at all, the sewer district. So I want to look at what we have there, what easements in place. I actually would probably like that to be county property versus district property, and we have a easement or agreement on it. But I don't know. I'm just going to look into it and give you guys an update on that. We're working on an agreement with the school district to operate and maintain the Rexplex fields. So we're working through that agreement. One item that came up, just wanted to make you aware of, was the water right to water that those fields out there. So I'm going to try and do a little bit of research and see where that water right came from. My guess is that it was set up for the Rexplex facility. So I don't know if it's under our name or the school district's name, but that's going to come up.
Well, and one thing that I just remember this from when I was coaching there, they don't turn that water on until pretty late in the season. It comes out of, there's something to do with the river and when the water comes on, and it's like, it's getting dry before they actually turn the water on, and then the sprinklers, they're a haphazard sort of. It may be better since the public works started working on it, but yeah. Back then it was like,
missed a lot of spots.
Yeah.
Well, and the school's taking over also. I think they're more local. They're right there. And we just want to make sure everything's done correctly with the rights and how that will work out. Go ahead.
I was just thinking, I know we invested a fairly large amount of money in some new pumps and new equipment for that sprinkler system when we took it over just over a year ago. That maybe ought to be something that, and maybe you're already aware and have discussed that with them, but I think we ought to.
Part of the agreement is we're going to list all the property or equipment associated with this. Perfect. And where that goes and why.
That's great.
Technically, we did not purchase a pump, though.
Oh, so okay.
We never fully followed through with that.
Interesting.
Yeah. The last thing, and I'll forward you an email, but we got an estimate from Wasatch Civil their agreement with the county is to do park master planning. So we got an estimate from them to do the master plan for the pickleball area and that property that goes up all the way up along the river there. So I'll forward that to you. We can have a look at it and see what we want to do moving forward, where we would get those funds from. But I think that would be a phenomenal next step on what we can do with that property. So that's all I got.
But the rec does have some money that
could be contributed towards that.
I would really like to see a mini motocross, a pit motocross thing, if we could figure it out to where that all the Wilkinsons did get awarded the road over there on Commercial Street, and they had talked to Brett about giving us all that dirt, and we have all that swamp area out there that we could use dirt for, and they just want to give it to us. So
yeah, I think that would be an excellent
one. Thanks for reminding me. We also talked about, so the school is extending the sewer line up to the bus station, bus garage. We're also, I'm going to check with that contractor and see what the cost would be to extend that sewer line towards the fairgrounds for future. And I think it'd be phenomenal to have the sewer grounds sewered
and same with the rest areas that we'll have there at the park facility. So,
and also to go along with that, Jared, another item that the city has talked to me about is they say that we are putting in a trail as they're putting this the new commercial street in. They're putting in a trail all the way up to our property. So that's something in the Trails Committee that we need to discuss, of putting the river, I mean the trail up the river or up the fairgrounds or whatever.
And it would almost go to the golf course actually along the river.
Yeah,
it's a phenomenal. It'll give us phenomenal access. It'll be amazing. So
that's something we might.
An amazing river recreation access.
And river walk and things like that. So that would be something that I know we're going to put into the plan. But if there's any funding available to do that while they're doing theirs, it would be nice to continue it up.
Okay.
So the Mickelson mile becomes a 3 mile, 4 mile.
Commissioner Wilson?
Nothing else.
Okay. We have a motion to adjourn?
No.
A
motion to go into closed session to discuss the disposition of real property.
Okay, we have
After
a motion.
Which I'm sure we could adjourn.
We have a motion to go into closed session to discuss the disposition of real property. Do we have a second on the motion?
I'll second it.
Second. This will be a roll call vote. Commissioner Fackel?
Aye.
Commissioner McConnell?
Aye.
I vote aye. Commissioner Anderson?
Aye.
And Commissioner Wilson?
Aye. Motion, we take a 5 minute break.
Okay, so motion passes. We're going
to
take a brief 5 minute break and then we'll come back into closed session.
Okay. All right. Okay.